Welcome to module 20 of point set topology part 1. So today we will discuss one small application of the Baer's category theorem. As I have told you, all these three big theorems in metric spaces, they have many applications in analysis. For example, the Banach contraction mapping principle is used in the existence and uniqueness of initial value problems, boundary value problems, and so on in differential equations. So instead of calling theorem, people would like to call them as principle, because the result they want to use is the principle rather than the final result which Banach contraction mapping theorem says. Okay, so today we will just give you just a small application in the elementary analysis. Since we cannot discuss the big applications of this in function analysis in this course, you start with a domain inside R. Take a function, any function, real-valued function. Take subsets of J which are open intervals, non-empty open intervals. Those things I will denote by I. J could be any domain, connected, open connected, need not be a some open subset of R will do, that's all. Or even closed subsets of R, closed interval or whatever. The function has to have a domain, so J is that. For each fixed open, non-empty open interval contained inside J, let us put this notation omega Fi, which is the difference of the supremum and the infimum of fx taken over the entire of I. So you take the supremum first, get the infimum, and then take the difference. Or you can just look at modulus of fx minus fy and take the supremum of these quantities as x and y freely range over I. I is fixed here. For each I have this number. Okay, maybe this could be infinity also, I don't mind. Okay, plus infinity is also allowed. All right, so only thing is I am assuming that I is non-empty, so this will not be something like minus infinity plus infinity and so on, which will not make sense. So this always makes sense. So this quantity is called oscillation of F in I. So you can say that how the difference between Fx and Fy, how large it could be. So that is oscillation. Now for each fixed X, you take all neighborhoods of I, which are intervals, open intervals around I. Okay, put omega of fx equal to infimum of all this omega fi, where I range is now, x is fixed. Okay, so these are all subsets of the domain, whatever.
So AB should be J, na here?
AB could be J. So, you know, depends upon what you have taken for the domain of F. Normally, it does not matter because you will have to take I smaller and smaller. So it's around x, that is what is important. So omega of fx is called the oscillation of f at x. For example, I will just give you a very simple-minded example. Look at a step function. So here I am taking the domain as closed interval 0 to. Okay. It doesn't matter what you take, it doesn't matter. But I want to include a step function. So it should include some points wherein the breaking is over. I believe that you all know step function. So here is one. Fx is equal to 1 in the interval 0 to 1 open. It is equal to 2 from closed interval 1 to 2. So at 1, the x equal to 1, there is a break here. You can see. Okay. Then take any subinterval around I, around 1. This I is around 1. Okay. Look at or any subinterval, open subset you have to take, which contains I. Omega fi will be exactly 1. Okay. Now, if you take the infimum, it will be also 1. Okay, so omega f1 will be 1. Remember, omega fx is the infimum of all omega fi. Okay, here is the picture what happens. This is the step function. At 0 to 1, it is this one. Okay, I have deliberately changed it here in the thing. Here you could jump, or this point you could have put it here, doesn't matter. The difference modulus, okay, for any point here, the value, the difference is always 1. So the infimum is also 1. Okay, now you have definitions of continuous functions. Usually you take the domain to be an open set, right? So I have taken open interval finally. You discuss the continuity at closed intervals also finally. But to begin with, you take open intervals anyway. So take an open interval. Okay, take a point x inside that. Take a function. It is continuous at that point. If and don't leave, the oscillation at that point is 0. Okay, so this could have been right in the beginning your definition of continuity, because if and only, but you have defined continuity in a different way. So let us just check it. It's very straightforward. Okay, suppose omega fx is 0, then we want to prove that f is continuous in the epsilon delta definition. So given epsilon positive, we must produce delta such that omega fy is less than epsilon for all y, such that modulus of y minus delta is less than delta. Why? Because look at this. We want finally, given a point x and y, y near x, namely modulus of y minus x less than delta, modulus of fx minus of y may be less than epsilon. If that is true for all x, y inside that, the supremum will be also less than that, which is same thing as omega fi. So I am using this part of the definition here. These two are equal is obvious to verify. Only thing you have to know what is the meaning of supremum and infimum. All right. So now, omega fx is 0, first of all, implies there exists an open interval I around x such that omega fy must be less than epsilon. If the infimum is 0, this has to be less than epsilon, right? Also, you can see that you are taking infimum. When you take a smaller set of values, you will get. It's a larger set, the infimum could be larger. So omega of I1 will be less than omega at I2. F is common here, so there is F here. Choose delta positive such that I delta is x minus delta, x plus delta contained inside I. So this I delta is just in a short notation. Then omega of F I delta will be less than epsilon because I have already made omega of F I is less than epsilon. So now for any Y in I delta, what is the meaning of I delta? That modulus of Y minus X is less than delta. Okay. Look at all the infimum of FZ, such as that belonging to IZ. That will be left I delta, that will less than FY because I am taking infimum here. Y is one of the points here. And that FY will be less than supremum of all the FZ that belong to this one. Because FY occurs here as well as here. Therefore, when you take the difference FY minus FX, that will be less than omega F I delta, okay, which is supremum of this minus infimum of that. All right. So therefore, that will be less than epsilon. Okay, omega F delta is already chosen to be less than delta, less than epsilon because it is less than omega Fi. So this proves the continuity. The other way around is even simpler, so I will leave it to you as an exercise. This is just to warm up so that you might have heard on continuity, epsilon delta continuity definition, and so on. That's all. So what I am interested in is take F from R to R, any function, and DF be the set of all points at which F is discontinuous. So D for discontinuous. The set of points of discontinuity is an F sigma set. Okay, so this is the proposition. Okay. So here there is no continuity, remember. F is continuous at some point, it is not continuous at all the point. You have applied this G delta F sigma for continuous functions. Now I am taking set of discontinuities is F sigma. So how to prove this? These are standard methods in real analysis. So it is the method should be paid attention to. You know, they are educative, that is why you have there. Look at Sn, all points x in R such that omega fx is greater than or equal to 1 by n. Why I am looking at this? I am looking at points wherein omega fx is not 0. Omega fx is always non-negative. If it is 0, corresponds to continuities of f. So I am looking at points wherein it is positive. If it's positive, it must be bigger than or equal to 1 by n for some n. So that is why I look at this set. Okay. Then if you take df, which is all points wherein it is positive, will be the union of Sn. Right? Because every point must be bigger than 1 by n for something. At every point, something this must be bigger than 1 by n. So df will be union of Sn. We need to show that each Sn is closed, then this will be F sigma over. Okay. So here is something. I am not claiming omega Fx is continuous or anything. Okay. But greater than or equal to 1 by n is a closed set, is what I am claiming. If it were a continuous function, this would have been obvious. So let X be not in Sn. Okay, I should show that there is an open subset around X, some delta or whatever. For that, it is not in Sn. Okay, the whole open set is not in Sn. That means I am trying to prove that complement of Sn is open. Okay, suppose X is not in Sn, then omega Fx by definition is less than 1 by n. okay? Which in turn, what is omega fx? It is the infimum of all omega fi, where I is some interval around x. So that will, this is less than f, 1 by n means that there is an open set, open interval I such that x is inside I, and that oscillation inside I is less than 1 by n. Okay. For other intervals, it may be bigger, but at least one of them must be there. Otherwise, infimum will be bigger than equal to 1 by n. So infimum is less means one, at least one of the values must be less than 1 by n. But then for all y in I, okay, I is an open interval, remember, omega fy will be also less than 1 by n, because now I am to take infimum over all these things, one of the values is already 1 by n. Okay, when I range y, when I range I, okay, so where I is one of the things and y is ranging inside I. So for every I, fix y, around y, one of the value is 1 by n. So omega f y will be less than 1 by n. Okay, so from x to y we are coming through this interval. I is a common interval here. So once this happens, what happens? The whole interval I is contained inside the complement of Sn. For each point, you have got an interval, so Sn is open. All right? Okay. So coming to the proof of final theorem, what we are going to do is, combining this proposition, that this is f sigma set, okay, along with what? Along with our example, that, what was the example? Let us have a look at it. This example said that if you take any subset, closed subset of irrational numbers, then it is nowhere dense. So let us go here. That is the example here. Okay. The set of irrational numbers is not f sigma. Right? Why? If once it is contained inside irrational number, it is nowhere dense. So that is the discussion here. In fact, what we have done is, even if it contains a rational number, it is f sigma, because either rational numbers or irrational numbers, they don't contain any interval. But closed subset you have to take. All right. So the conclusion here is, there is no function from R to R which is continuous at all rational numbers and discontinuous at all irrational numbers. Why? DF for such a thing would be exactly equal to R minus Q. Then this proposition says that R minus Q is what? F sigma. There's no problem about that. But F sigma means what? All these essence are closed subsets of R minus Q. Therefore, it is no evidence. Therefore, I have written the irrational numbers as what? Countable union of no evidence sets. That is not possible, was the example. Okay. The countable union of no evidence sets is not possible for all the irrational numbers. So, there is no such function. So, this is not at all such a important result, but what, why I have put it here is just an illustration of the power of BCT, Bayer's category theorem, from very many things to very strong things it can conclude, very important things can conclude. Just to complete the picture, I want to remind you that if you interchange the role of rational and irrational here, there are such functions. There are continuous functions such that at all rational points they are discontinuous, and at all irrational points they are continuous. It is continuous. So the DF can be the set of rational numbers or any subset of it also. No problem. At a few points of irrational numbers also, it is just the irrational numbers is not possible. That is the conclusion of this theorem. Okay. So here is that function which has many, many names. So it goes back, idea goes back to Dirichlet. Dirichlet had some slightly different. He put one here instead of zero here. So Thome has slightly modified it, and it becomes a quite interesting example. So fx is zero if x is irrational, and 1 by q if x is p by q with GCD of pq equal to 1. Okay. So just to remind you, what will be f of 0 in this f of 0 by this definition? See, you have to write 0 is a rational number. How do you write 0? 0 as 0 divided by 1 you have to write. That is the only way GCD of P and Q can be equal to 1 when P is 0. Therefore, the value of this function at x equal to 0 is 1 by 1. What is 1? Okay. I'm just explaining the definition of this one. Okay, suppose you have 5 by 10, then you should write it as 1 by 2, and then it will be 1 by 2. Suppose you have 15 by 25, then you will have to write it as 3 by 5, then this should be 1 by 5, and so on. The continuity of this one is interesting property of rational numbers, or more so of irrational number. That I will not discuss. This is very standard. Okay. So let us stop here. Next time we will do one more serious result, and that will be the end of this chapter. Okay. So tomorrow we will do one more serious result about metric spaces, namely completion of metric spaces. Any questions? Tell me.
So this the theorem about discontinuity, set of discontinuities being f sigma set, is there any analogous result for metric spaces?
Metric spaces?
Yes. Can it be extended?
Complete metric spaces, yes. You see, complete metric spaces, you can formally say, what you need to show, first of all, you can try to see that this omega fx greater than or equal to 1, you should be able to show that it's closed. So where, how far you have used it, what is the meaning of the oscillation, etc. You will have to be very careful, you have to define. Okay. So what is that? You have to take neighborhoods instead of I. You can just restrict yourselves to just closed open balls around that point. No problem. Look at all x, y ranging in the open ball. Take modulus of f minus fy. But the values have to be real valued functions, okay? Are not arbitrary. Then there is no infimum and supremum. So domain can be arbitrary metric space, but you have to put completeness. Okay, then at least it makes sense. So you have to check it. It is a good exercise. Try it. Good question. So try it and see how far all these things go. Okay. Countable union automatically comes just like this one. So if you can show that these are closed subsets, which is not difficult anyway. Complement is open is similar to proof is here. Okay. Now the problem here is why these SNs, okay, are no evidence. So you don't have irrational numbers and so on. They're in an arbitrary space. Okay. So what is the conclusion? It is F sigma up to there, you are fine. Okay, so you have to assume that the set of, suppose assume the set of discontinuities is no evidence. Does not, sorry, has empty interior, yeah, only empty interior, no contents, no. That kind of things you have to show first, assume that. Then that cannot be a set of discontinuities, set of continuities, sorry, set of discontinuities. Okay. So what I mean to say, there is no concept of the set of irrational numbers or complement of irrational numbers and so on in arbitrary metric space. So you have to replace the corresponding thing by correct hypothesis, that's all. Okay. All right, let's stop here.